studied about various cases about hydrolysis of ethers in acidic condition. Going further, we'll see hydrolysis, but these are the types of ethers where you have or we can say geminal ethers. Got it? If at all we have RCH with OR dash and OR dash, which means geminal ether for diether formations, those are called acetals. Okay, this is the general name of that group. Suppose if instead of one OR dash we have OH, we call it as hemiacetal. Okay, if acetal undergoes hydrolysis, both these groups RO dash will come out as alcohols, and here water will get added up and it will become aldehyde. On the other hand, if you take hemiacetal and hydrolyze that, we will get same aldehyde, and this one mole of ROH will come out as alcohol. This is what you will observe when hydrolysis of acetals and hemiacetals are done. Suppose if there is an acetal given here, so you can see this is an acetal form, and H plus, because you are adding acid, we will have source of H plus, so it gets protonated. So as it gets protonated, we can expect this to form OR dash and OH R with positive charge. The minute there is a leaving group formed on the carbon, immediately the lone pair will start making a double bond formation here, and this sigma bond will take away its electrons, thereby we will have this as RCH double bond OR with positive charge, right? And that group has been left as ROH, R dash OH, sorry, these are R dash. So this is the first step which you have seen. First protonation has happened, right? Immediately as soon as the protonation has happened, you can see the lone pair here supports as a double bond, and this becomes a good leaving group, and it will come as alcohol. So first mole of alcohol has already come. Now the remaining group, how it is, check it out. We right now we have RCH double bond O R dash with this getting positive charge, right? So this is how we have it. Again H2O will attack on carbon, because carbon would get sufficient delta positive on that. As soon as it attacks, we will get this as RCH, correct, with OR dash and with OH2 plus. We will get this as OH2 plus, which I am writing it as OH with another H here. Okay, so you can think this way, OH2 plus. The lone pair present on oxygen here will immediately get protonated within the molecule, what we call it as an intramolecular proton transfer, and we will get this as RCH OH R dash plus and OH. Again, it raised to a good leaving group. The lone pair supports here, this group will leave. So what do we have right now is RCH double bond OH plus plus R dash OH. So one more R dash OH has come out. So here also let me write this as R dash OH. So you can see the two moles of R dash OH which were present earlier on the group, both have come out, and this group will give away H plus because it is in acidic solution, and will end up with aldehydes. Okay, now check this carefully. The carbon, the oxygen which is present with water, let me keep marking that here, got it, that is the one which is carried here throughout. So if it is an isotopic, that would form the isotopic form. So aldehyde would have that isotopic form. So if these two oxygens would have been isotopic, both would be in the form of alcohols only, these two forms. See the questions now. I have taken few acetals and hemiacetals. All you need to do, suppose, see the trick, simple trick here. If this is what, this is hemiacetal. Remind you once again, if you have on the same carbon, on the alpha carbon, we have OH and OR group, right? So geminally aligned OH and OR group, then that is called hemiacetal. So we have an hemiacetal group. If there are two OR groups on that, that is called acetal. So on hemiacetal, always remember that this oxygen with OH group, right? The oxygen with OH group, that will always retain in the aldehyde form. You just go back to the mechanism here. You can see this is the hemiacetal form. On the hemiacetal form, you can see OH group, that is the one which has been retained altogether in the aldehyde form. Okay, so same thing. So easiest way to do is just break the bond here. Wherever you find hemiacetal, don't break the bond on OH side, break the bond on OR side and make the respective products. Put the respective products, which is CH3, CHO with star on it, plus PHOH. See the next one. Keep writing with me. You will break here. So the product would be CH3, CHO, plus CH3, OH with star here. Next one also, breaking the bond here. So we would have CH3, CHO, plus C2H5OH. Suppose here, if you observe in all of these cases, 1, 2, 3, there is hydrogen, hydrogen, hydrogen here, which means this is an hemiacetal kind. Instead of hydrogen, there are two R groups here, then it is called hemiketal because it is coming from the source of ketone. So if you hydrolyze that, we will get a ketone and R-OH which is coming. So same mechanism, except that this time we should get ketones in the product. Correct? So let me show the products here. Again, I'll keep breaking the bond first. See, I'll break here, break here, break here. So respectively, I will write the products here. So we can get this as CH3, C double bond O, CH3 with PHOH, here CH3, C double bond O, CH3 with ETOH, here cyclohexanone and CH3OH. Make a note, what is hemiketal, right? We have seen something about acetals. I told you acetals are CH3, CH, OR dash and OR dash. I have called this as acetal, right? So remember this, this is what we have called as acetal. Now instead of this H, if at all we have some R group, we call that as ketal. Just like hemiketals, now we have ketals, yeah? Now ketals could be cyclic also, like this. For example, if I take a ketone, cyclohexanone, and treat that with ethanol in the presence of dry HCl, we will be able to generate this cyclic ketal. This is something which we will be learning in aldehydes and ketones, but I am here to tell you that what cyclic ketal looks like. Okay, so this is an acetal, right? And if you have a simple CH3, some R group here, some OR dash, OR dash like this, then this is ketal. If it is in a cyclic form, it is called cyclic ketal. That's all. Okay. So now check this out. If you have acetals, ketals or cyclic ketals, in all the way, you need to learn how the bond breaking take place. Got it? What we have learned, observe one case carefully. Let's rest all, you can do it like a shortcut. Suppose if you observe this carbon here, this is the reference carbon on which we have one OR group here and the other OR group like this. So which means both that OR group should be broken. So in that case, I have to break here also and I have to break here also. And the water is the one which will get connected on this carbon. Got it? So if that is the case, what should be the product here? So we will get this as an open chain now. With, if I give the numbering 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 carbons. So here on this carbon, we will have CHO. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. On fifth carbon here, I will have CH2OH. And one CH3OH has already come out. I guess this point is clear, everyone. How to put that? So wherever there is an acetal, ketal or cyclic ketals, just break both the oxygen bonds during hydrolysis, carbon oxygen bonds, and then substitute that with an aldehyde form or a keto form. I'll help you with the breaking of the bond. Just write the product. Breaking here and here. Breaking here and here. Same thing what you got here, CHO and CH2OH. Okay. Oh, sorry. Here breaking is only one. OH on this side. OH on this side. In the middle, it will be CHO. We can see here it is forming keto group here and can have alcohol this way. Alcohols are forming here, and that single carbon, if you observe, that is the one which is forming the aldehyde part. Here also you would break from here and here, 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 here and here. So how many of them are there here? So we can see three moles of CHO. So there is no alcohol form present there. Right. If you people have done, just this time with the isotopic oxygen, I have kept it. So you should be able to get this correct now. Now come to the reactions with HI. First, what we have seen is the hydrolysis. Now reaction with HI here, concentrated HI cases. See, if you take dilute HI, which is similar to that of writing it as dilute H plus cases, which we have done so far. So currently we are doing only concentrated HI cases. HBr will also, concentrated HBr will also give a similar case, but relatively slow. And concentrated HCl does not give the reaction fast. It's very, very slow. So we do not take these two cases at all. You would be asked only about concentrated HI cases. How the concentrated HI will make the cleavage of aldehyde groups. Got it? Check this out. If we have an ROR group here and we treat that with concentrated HI, first an oxonium ion is formed, then I minus, which is relatively a strong nucleophile, will attack on R. Now this attack could be from in both ways. It may happen by SN2 mechanism or it may happen by SN1 mechanism. If it happens by SN1 mechanism, we are expecting that either it should be 1 degree, okay, or it should be 2 degree. Then I will get this as ROH plus RI. Got it? And here R should be 2 degree, 3 degree, right? Then it would go for SN1. Allyl benzyl. See, in all of these cases, especially 2 degree allyl benzyl, we will see SN1, SN2 both are happening, but SN1 is more favored because rate of SN1 is faster than SN2. This is one thing you must understand. So reaction can drive by both SN2 as well as SN1, but you will always get the major product which is on SN1 side. So what are the products we can expect? We will get this as ROH and the other one you will get it as RI. Okay. So see the mechanism. With one of the cases, I'll show the mechanism, then you can write it back. If you treat this, you know, methyl ether with concentrated HI, first an oxonium ion is formed, less charge here, then I minus will attack. You can see both of them are primary, or these are methyl groups, so definitely SN2 is favored here. So by SN2 mechanism it is favored. So we will get this as CH3OH plus CH3I. CH3OH or CH3I. right? Next, if you check out the second case, now we have primary and primary here also. So here also there is 1 degree and 1 degree. So based upon, but it is unsymmetrical ether. So obviously again an oxonium ion formation, then I minus will attack. So this time I minus will attack on least crowded one. So this group will rearrange. So we'll get this as CH3, CH2, OH plus CH3I. Okay. Again the mechanism is favored by SN2. See the third case. Third case we have again reaction with HI. This time there is a secondary carbocation, a secondary group here, 1 degree, and this side it is 2 degrees. Correct. So we can see the mechanism happening in both ways. First, let me show you SN1 kind, because SN1 is the one which would usually happen with major, right? So I minus first. Sorry, let me show first the SN2 case here. So I minus will attack here. This group will leave. So we would get this as CH3, CH2, I, and CH3, CH, CH, and OH. This is by SN2. Now check this out. If you have at least one side is 1 degree, please concentrate carefully. If one side is one degree, then SN2 would be the major product. This would be, these are the major products. Got it? Why? Because I minus is a strong nucleophile, so it won't wait till the formation of carbocation. If both sides are second degree, if both sides are second degree, then SN1 would be major product. You're getting that? So be careful with this case. So if you have 1 degree, 2 degree, still go for SN2 mechanism as the major product. Right. So note the first three now, everyone. Now check this, guys. While writing this case, one thing is important. See, examiner can give you as concentrated HI. He may simply give as HI, or he may give you as cold concentrated HI. All of these meant the same thing. Okay. Cold concentrated HI, or simply HI, or concentrated HI, we are expected to do this. Here on one side we have 1 degree, on the other side we have 3 degree. Got it? So what do you think we should go for? One side we have 1 degree, the other side we have 2 degree. First we will have protonation done here. Got it? Because there is a strong tertiary group, which means we can get a stable carbocation formation. And although there is an SN2 that is happening, remember SN2 is also happening, SN1 will be more favored in this case. So SN1 case. So you would not be specifically asked whether it is going for SN1 or SN2, but major product can be asked. The major product will be always with, which is by SN1. So you would get by SN1 it is. So first we will get CH3OH, and the other side we will have CH3 with carbocation, and then I minus will attack. So we will get the final product as this iodide. Very, very important case this is. This is the most repeated question, you know, from ethers. So remember this. This case is important. Major product is important, not whether it is SN1 or SN2, because both are favoring here. This is the major product, this one and this one. Now in this case it could be asked to you, like, which is the specific mechanism. Reason being, SN2 can never happen in this case. One thing, it is a phenylic group on one side. Second side, it is at the tertiary case. Okay, so one side is tertiary, the other side is phenyl. So obviously both are the bad cases for SN2. So check out, first the protonation will happen, and next there would definitely be bond breaking here. So we would get two products, PHOH and tertiary carbocation, and this is driving through SN1 mechanism. Here examiner could ask you, like, we know whether it is an SN1 or SN2 driven, and then I minus if it attacks, you would get this as CH3, CH3 and I. So these two are the major products. Next case, we are not getting any stable carbocation. First of all, one side there is a 1 degree case, the other side there is a phenyl case. So definitely SN2 is not very SN1 is not very favorable here, because there is no stable carbocation forming. So you can see first on the oxonium ion, I minus will directly attack on this 1 degree, this bond will break. So we would get this as PHOH plus CH3 CH2I, and this is driven by SN2 mechanism. See the next case. The next case, one side I have benzyl, the other side I have 1 degree. So benzyl is a very good stable carbocation, so but at the same time it can give SN2 also. So we may have both things happening, but again SN1 will be the major product in it. So what we can expect here, first on the oxonium ion here, right, we will have this bond breaking taking place on this side. So we can have CH2 plus and CH3 CH2 OH. On that, if you treat with I minus, you will get the product as this CH2I. So this will be the major product. This is via SN1. That does not mean SN2 is not happening. SN2 is also happening, but SN1 comes to be the more rate. Just like in hydrolysis, we saw that these are the cases which does not undergo hydrolysis. Same thing can be observed here, concentrated HI, because neither they can facilitate SN1 nor they can facilitate SN2, so they will not react with concentrated HI. Concentrated HI, the other way to call that is a cold concentrated HI or simply HI, okay. These are all same cases, guys, so I'm just going up. You can note it down later if you have not done that. Let's check out second case. Second case is same concentrated HI, but this time I'm taking in excess. So you would be provided with the wording, it has concentrated HI excess or simply HI excess like this, or you would be given this as hot concentrated HI. This meant the same thing. Hot concentrated HI, when we are taking, it is like, you know, I have sufficient amount of I minus which are continuously attacking as the nucleophiles. Got it. So now whatever we have studied in case 1, it is all the same. Either it will go for SN1, SN2 depending upon those cases. But the alcohol part which has come will again react with this HI, and finally RI will be the product. So the products will only have iodides. This is one iodide and this is the other iodide. So wherever the alcohol has formed, convert that part into iodide forms, okay. So see the way how simple shortcut is, in ethers just break the bond on both sides, give them as iodides, on the center carbon make it as water, center oxygen make it as water, that's all, got it. So use that shortcut. So everything you have to convert into iodides. Both sides it is 1 degree, the lone pair is attacking on H plus, you will get an oxonium ion here. And we know that both side, if it is 1 degree, it will facilitate SN2 mechanism. So I minus will attack on the least substituted carbon. This bond will break. So what do we have here? We will have this as CH3 CH2 OH plus CH3I. Okay. Now check out this case here, the one which is CH3 CH2OH, correct. So what we should have, this will further react with HI because you are taking excess. So this will become CH3 CH2OH2 plus, again I minus will attack on that, H2O will be removed. This is also done by SN2 mechanism, and finally I will get this as CH3 CH2I. So what are the products we have? We have this as one product and we have this as one product. See the second case, I'm just writing the products here. You break on both the sides, you know, give the iodine on this side, iodine on this side, because both are very favorable cases. Both side we can see SN1, this side SN1 and SN2 both are favored, this side SN2 is favored. As long as both side, either of the SN1 or SN2 is favored, convert everything into iodides. Just to showcase the mechanism how it is happening, First, it will attack on this. Oxonium ion will be formed. I minus. Now, if it go through, carbocation mechanism as well as SN2 mechanism. But since this is more for SN1, so we can have first the bond breaking is seen. We can have this as CH3, CH2, OH, and the other side is pH, CH2, carbocation, which on treatment with I minus will become pH, CH2I. So benzyl iodide is formed, and this alcohol which has formed again treat with HI to form CH3, CH2I. So you could see eventually those are the two products which we are expecting. Check this. We can't simply break because we have excess HI now, because the minute we have phenyl group, there is a partial double bond character, because this oxygen will support as resonance for phenyl. So breaking that oxygen and carbon bond would be difficult. So even if you add excess HI, only this side of the part will form the iodide. This side of the part will remain like an alcohol only. In this case, it is phenols. Okay. So check this case. So CH3, CH2O, pH on treatment with HI excess, we will get this as iodide, and this would stay as phenol. Okay. Let's see the mechanism. So the lone pair will attack on this H plus. You will get the oxonium ion formation, and we know that it is at a primary position, so definitely SN2 is favored. So this is an SN2 case. So we will get this as CH3, CH2I, and pHOH. Further reaction does not take place, which means if you have further HI reaction here, nothing will happen. So I have written the reason here. The reason is that partial double bond character between carbon and oxygen. Suppose if the question is mentioned as anhydrous HI, that's a completely different case. See, in the above two cases, when you are using concentrated HI, we definitely have some amount of water, right? Not sufficient amount, but that would be sufficient amount to increase the polarity in the reaction. So that means polar mechanisms are favorable, like SN1. But if you do not have, water at all, which is an anhydrous HI, and you are treating that with ethers, then even the 3 degree alkyl halide becomes difficult to get forming, because they won't get any stabilizing factor. You may remember when SN1 was happening, solvent has a huge importance, and the reason the solvent is giving the dipole-dipole interaction is the reason why that they are breaking into carbocations. Because there is no water present here, that ability of forming 3 degree alkyl case would be very less. Okay. So always think in terms of SN2 here. Got it? Always think in terms of SN2 here and proceed for the further reaction. Got it? Let me show you how. Suppose if you have this ether reaction with HI, first an oxonium ion, and this R minus will attack on either of the R here, and it is favored only by SN2, you will get ROH and RI. Okay. So let me follow through a question here. On one side it is 1 degree, on the other side it is 3 degree. Got it? As soon as the oxonium ion is formed here, so I minus will immediately attack on this 1 degree case, OH is going to come. So what we are seeing, although there could be a stable carbocation formation here, the reaction is only driven by SN2. So what will be the product here now? CH3, CH2I, okay, plus CH3, CH3, CH3 and OH. You have to stop the reaction here itself. Here we can check this out. Suppose if you have this kind of a case where you have a benzyl case, this could form a very strong carbocation here, very stable carbocation here. But yet after protonation, you can see this oxonium ion is formed first, and this I minus will attack here only to give this as SN2 mechanism, and we'll get the product as CH3CH2I and PHCHCH3 and OH. This has been the major product. Third case, you know that again, in case if you have both phenyls on the same side, right, or bridgehead carbons on the same side, you know that it will never make any reactions at all. Now, this is a very good case of SN1, it should be, right, because it could be a tertiary carbocation, but still, like, the yield is almost less, we say there is no reaction here also. So, in fact, this has been the evidence, this case has been like then evidence to say that SN1 reaction is hardly favored with anhydrous HI. So, in conclusion, you can remember this, in which case what should be taken. If you take concentrated HI or cold concentrated HI is same. HI excess or hot HI excess is same, and anhydrous HI is the same case, is the different case here, last one. So, on these three cases, what is favored, I have written it as a table, just go through that. Last thing is Zissel's method to determine the amount of OMA groups, how many methoxy groups are present, got it? Just give the heading as Zissel's method. This is a method to determine the number of OMA groups present on phenolic ethers. For instance, if we have some n number of OMA groups here, like in this case there are three of them, so maybe some n number of groups, I need to identify how many OMA groups are there. So first thing I will do is the given sample, you know, phenoxy ether samples, this I would take it as W grams, and accordingly we know what is the molar mass of that particular given compound. Next, we react that with excess HI, okay, so that we can get 3 moles of CH3I. We know that this methyl will go through SN2 mechanism and all this would come as CH3I. Then react that with AgNO3, and we know that silver would react with iodide to form AgI. Got it? So, we will get 3 moles of AgI here, correct, considering if you have 3 methyl groups. So, what we do, this AgI separated and washed out and dried, and then its weight is been checked. So, let me call this as X grams. These are the same terminology used in the formula as well. So, remember, X is the amount of weight of AgI in grams, W is the weight of sample in grams, got it, M is the molar mass of the sample. Now, one thing we know, that number of moles of AgI formed will be equal to N times the number of moles of compound, where N itself represents the number of methoxy groups, right? So, I can write that as N is representing number of methoxy groups. So, thereby I can write this number of moles as weight of the AgI divided by molar mass of AgI is equal to N times of weight of the compound divided by molar mass of the compound. So, if I substitute those terms, it is actually x by AgI molar mass, which is 108 plus 127, that will be equal to N times of weight of compound, which is W by M. So, from here we can calculate what is the value of N, right? So, that would be equal to X by, this would come as how much, 235, X by 235 into M by W. So, that's how we can calculate number of methoxy groups. So, given any data, you should be able to figure out how many number of methoxy groups are present.